Okay, I think we'll start. So last week, I introduced some basic quantities associated to the Ising model. We saw the finite volume Gibbs distributions in particular. And the quantity we will be most concerned with today, let me just recall them. It's the partition function. So we have some arbitrary boundary condition, finite subset lambda in ZD. And then the boundary condition was the partition function was defined as the sum over all configuration compatible with the boundary condition of E minus, let's write it like that, E minus the Hamiltonian energy of the configuration. And then we introduced the finite volume pressure, which I denoted psi lambda. It was a function of, okay, this is of course a function of the two parameters beta and h, on which the Hamiltonian depends. And the finite volume pressure, so it's a function of beta and h, it's given by 1 over lambda times the log of the partition function. Okay. And then we introduced also the average magnetization density. So the magnetization density was the random variable 1 over lambda sum over I in lambda sigma I, which measures the average spin in the box lambda. And then the average magnetization density was just the expected value of M lambda in the corresponding Gibbs state and under the corresponding Gibbs distribution. Beta and H, this of course is also a function of beta and H. So these were just some things we saw last week. And we saw that this quantity, the average magnetization density in the box lambda, was related to the pressure in a simple way. It was just the derivative with respect to h of the pressure. Okay. Then last time I finished by saying that a priori we have some problem because we would like to show that when h is equal to zero and beta is sufficiently large, the magnetization density, the average magnetization density here, has a discontinuity. But since both this function are real analytic, they cannot have discontinuities. So what I was trying to convey was that there is a need to go to the limit of infinite systems in order to have some hope of observing some genuine discontinuity of such functions. So that's what we are going to do today. So we want to define some notion of convergence of subsets of ZD to ZD itself. So convergence of subsets. And we'll need two notions of convergence of subsets of ZD to ZD itself. The first one, so we will say, okay, we will say that the sequence lambda n of finite subsets of ZD, okay, let me do it like that. The first definition is that it increases to ZD. Increases to ZD, which we will write lambda n with an arrow going upward in ZD if the two following conditions are satisfied. First, the sequence is monotone, that is that lambda n plus 1 contains lambda n. And the second one is that if you let n go to infinity, then you reach ZD in its entirety, so the union over n of lambda n is ZD. So that's the first notion of convergence that we will need. And then sometimes, in particular today, we will need some stronger notion because sequences like that, which grow to ZD in this sense, they can be extremely wild. And we will need to have some regularity in order to prove some results. And in particular, we'll need to control the way the boundary of these sets is growing with n. So the second notion is that of convergence. So the sequence lambda n converges to ZD in the sense of Van Hove. If, well, if it increases to ZD, but in addition, the limit as n goes to infinity of the size of the boundary of lambda n divided by lambda n is going to zero. The limit is zero. So that's the inner boundary of lambda n. I think I defined it last week, I don't remember. So the inner boundary of a set A, just in case, is the set of all vertices in A such that there exists some vertex not in A, which is a neighbor of I. Okay. So that's really the boundary, but the boundary is seen from inside. Doesn't matter for this definition, but we have to specify what we mean by boundary. Okay, so these are the two notions of convergence to ZD that we will use, and today we will focus mostly on the second one. Let me just give one example of that will come back very often, of a sequence which is convergent in the strongest sense. So for example, the sequence, what I will denote Bn, which is just the cube of side lengths 2n plus 1, satisfies I've not said how I will denote this. So I want some way of denoting this. This I will denote it lambda n with a double arrow converges to ZD. So that means, so with a single arrow it just increases to ZD, and with double one it increases to ZD, but the ratio of the boundary over the size of the boundary over the size of the set goes to zero. So this converges to ZD in the sense of Van Hove. And now I let, as an exercise for you, exercise 3-4, give an example of a sequence lambda n such that lambda n increases to ZD, but lambda n does not converge to ZD in the sense of Van Hove, just so that you understand the difference between the two. Okay, that's the notion of convergence of subsets that we will need. So with this, okay, maybe I will do it here. With this, I can return to the notion of pressure and magnetization density, but now for infinite systems. So pressure and magnetization part 2. And the main definition, which is also a theorem, the pressure that's one of the main quantity in this theory, the pressure psi of beta h, which is defined as the limit as lambda converges to ZD in the sense of Van Hove of psi, okay, can make it like that, beta h, the limit of the finite volume pressures along any sequence lambda which converges to ZD in the sense of Van Hove for an arbitrary boundary condition. This quantity is well defined. So the limit exists. Is well defined. It does not depend, the limit does not depend on the choice of the sequence lambda, nor on the boundary condition. Does not depend on the sequence of lambda, provided it goes to ZD in the sense of Unhoff, or on the boundary condition. Okay. That's a very robust quantity. Moreover, psi of beta h is equal to psi of beta minus h, and the function which associates to beta h, the pressure at beta h, is convex. Okay, this is, these are all the properties we want. So this limiting pressure, it shares the same type of property we saw for the finite volume pressure, and this will play the central role in what we'll do later. Okay, so let me prove this theorem. So it will take some time. So the proof is done in several steps. The first thing we will do is to prove the existence of this limit for a particular sequence of boxes, lambda, and for a particular boundary condition, which will be the free boundary condition. So step one, say one. Okay, convergence of psi, free boundary condition, dn, where, so that's, where dn is a very special set of boxes, which is the set 1, 2, 2 to the n, power d. So it's a set of cubes, okay, of side lengths which grows like powers of 2. So each time you double the size. As n increases, you double the size at each step. Okay. And the idea of the proof is to show that the sequence, show that the sequence of finite volume pressures with free boundary condition in this box dn is a Cauchy sequence. Of course, if you do that, you automatically have convergence of the sequence.
Does that converge to ZD?
It does not converge to ZD, but does not matter for this quantity. You could always recenter the cube. I could always shift it. And that does not change the value of the finite volume pressure. It does not depend on where I put the origin. Right? So for the computation, it's convenient to do it like that. But if you prefer to center the set dn, it would not change anything in the proof. Right? But I agree with you. What is important here is that the boundary of the set dn grows to infinity slower than the bulk of the volume of the set dn. Okay. The ratio of the boundary over the volume is going to zero. Okay, so how do you prove that this is a Cauchy sequence? Well, a natural way to proceed, since the finite volume pressure, where is it? It's here. The finite volume pressure is defined through the partition function. What I will do is that I will take the partition function in the box dn plus 1, and I will try to relate it to the partition function in the box dn. So that's not so difficult. Let me make a picture. Maybe let me make a picture like that. Just for illustration. So that's supposed to be the box dn plus 1. So it has 2 to the power n plus 1 vertices as a side length. Okay, it's a cube in dimension d. Okay. And what I will do is that I'm going to take my knife and to cut the system into 4 pieces. So I will cut all these edges. Let me remove the right ones. All these edges, I'm going to cut them away. And if I cut them away, what remains? something like that. Okay. What remains is 2 to the power d copies of the systems with the box dn. Okay, so this I will call dn1, dn2, and so on and so forth, like that. And the last one is dn2 to the power d. Okay, these are copies of the box dn. This I can always do. And then once I've realized that I can easily go from the box dn plus 1 to 2 to the power d copies of the box dn, I can relate the energy of a configuration in this box to the energy of the configuration in this, the same configuration in these four boxes. That's what I'm going to do now. Let's take a configuration omega in omega dn plus 1. Okay. And then the Hamiltonian in dn plus 1 with free boundary condition of omega. This is equal to, by definition, maybe I should just recall you what was the definition because you only saw it once last week, so it is by definition it's minus beta times the sum over all pairs of nearest neighbor in the box, which I denoted like that, of omega I omega j, and then minus h, sum over I in lambda omega I. So lambda is the n plus 1. Omega I. So that's just the definition in this. I can decompose as follows. So this I can write as, say, sum over these boxes here, which are indexed by this index 1, 2, up to 2 to the power d. So I will sum over the boxes, say L, which goes from 1 to 2 to the power d. Then I have what? I have minus beta, sum over all edges ij, which belong to epsilon dn l omega I omega j minus h sum over I which belongs to dn l omega I. So if I stop here, I'm making a mistake because I'm taking into account all these interactions here, all these interactions there, but I'm not taking into account the interaction between these pairs of spins, all those which I've cut out. So I have to add them. So I have plus, say, sum over L different from L prime, which are these indices from 1 to 2 to the power d. And then we have something like, say, minus beta, sum over I in d n L, j in d n L prime, I and j neighbors, omega I, omega j. Okay, this is the error I'm making. This is the contribution from the edges that I've cut. Okay. But this I can bound, so let me give a name to this part. This part here, I will call it R, reminder, okay, Rn, Rn plus 1. It's the reminder I have, so the mistake I make when I only keep this part. And it's immediate that this remainder is bounded uniformly in the configuration. So what we have is that Rn plus 1, this remainder, it's smaller than, well, certainly we have a beta. And then I have beta times the total number of these edges which I've cut out. So how many of these guys do I have? Well, how many of these guys do I have, say, first these vertical ones here? So I have as many as the size of the square, which is here. So it's a square of size, side length 2n plus 1. So I have 2n plus 1 vertices there. But of course, you have to imagine this in dimension d. So it's a d minus 1 dimensional face. So I have 2n plus 1 to the power d minus 1 vertices in such a face there of the cube. So that's the number of these edges. And these edges here, they are all orthogonal to one particular plane, coordinate plane. Okay, and I have one for each possible coordinate direction. So I have d of these guys. So what I get is d times 2 to the power, so the size of this, so 2n plus 1, to the power d minus 1. Okay, so that's the size, the number of vertices I have in a face of our cube, dn plus 1. That's the number of faces I have to cut. Here, 2 on the picture, because the picture is two-dimensional. And that's what I pay for each of those because of the beta, which is here. Okay, so that's just beta d 2 to the power n plus 1 d minus 1. Okay. So now that I have a control of these things, I can. So here, of course, what we have, what I've written here, this first part, or let's say it's better to do it maybe here, this first part here. This is just the Hamiltonian in the NL, let's say, of omega. Okay. That's the Hamiltonian in the L subbox, and I'm summing over the boxes. So the Hamiltonian in the big box is the sum of the Hamiltonian in the small boxes plus a small remainder. Small, we'll see why it's small in a second, small enough. So now I want to move to the pressure, so I need to deal with the partition function. So I want to take the partition function with free boundary condition in the box dn plus 1. So that's by definition the sum over all configuration in the box dn plus 1. And then we have e minus h dn plus 1 omega. And then I can use this decomposition here to get, say, first an upper bound. So I get sum over all omega in omega dn plus 1. This I replace by the product L equal 1 to 2 to the power d e minus h dn L of omega. Okay. And then there is this error term, which is bounded here, so I can take it out. This will be bounded by e beta d 2 to the power n plus 1 d minus 1. This gives me my upper bound. And now notice that this factorizes over the subboxes. For each subbox, I have a Boltzmann weight minus a corresponding Hamiltonian. And this I can also factorize. Of course, this sum I can write it as sum over, say, L, or say, let's write it like this, product from L to 2, from 1 to 2 to the power d, sum over omega L, in omega dnl. That's the same. I'm just, instead of fixing the spin in whole the box dn plus 1, say this one is plus or minus, this one is plus or minus, and so on and so forth, I can just fix the configuration on each of these subboxes. This amounts to the same thing. Okay, so that's what I'm doing here. And if I do that in this way, what I get is, okay, the error term, which is still there. And then you get product from L, which is equal, which goes from 1 to 2d, sum over omega in omega dn L, say omega L, doesn't matter, and then e minus h dn L omega L. It depends only on the spins in the box. Okay. And what do we recognize here? This is exactly the partition function in the box DNL, okay, with free boundary condition. But the fact that it's the box DNL does not matter. For all these boxes, this sum is exactly the same, does not depend on the index L, so I can just write a partition function in the box DN. So now I have a relation some inequality which relates the partial function in the box dn plus 1 with the partial function in the box dn. Okay, let me write down what we obtained. So what we have obtained is that Z dn plus 1 smaller than E beta d 2n plus 1 d minus 1, and then this partition function to the power 2 to the power d. Okay. Of course, I could have got just as easily a lower bound. Let me try to find some color choke. So I could get a lower bound here by just putting a minus here in the error term, so which would carry a minus term here and a minus here. Okay, this would be exactly the same. Now, once I have this, it's very easy to obtain analogous result for the pressure. Remember that the pressure is just 1 over the size of the box times the log of the partition function. So I just take the log on both sides and I divide by the volume. So this gives me psi, sorry, dn plus 1. And when I do it in this side, let me first do it for the upper bound. Then I get, when I take the log, this gives me beta d 2 to the power n plus 1 d minus 1 divided by the size of the box dn plus 1. Then I take the log, so this I get the log of this plus the log of that, so plus 2 to the power d times the log of this partition function, which I can write as the pressure in the n, but then I have to multiply by the size of the n, and everything has to be divided by the size of the n plus 1. Okay. So that's the log of the partition function, this guy. And I have to divide by the n plus 1 to construct the pressure on this side. Okay, so that's what I get. And now let's just see what remains. So what is the size of the n plus 1 here? This quantity here, so it's, the n plus 1 is a cube of side length 2n plus 1, 2 to the power n plus 1. So the volume of this cube is 2 to the power n plus 1 to the power d. So that's 2 to the power n plus 1 times d. Okay. So when you cancel the numerator and the denominator, you see that you have d minus 1 times n plus 1. Here you have d times n plus 1. So what remains, okay, it's actually an identity. What remains here is, okay, beta d, 2 to the power minus n minus 1. Okay. And then for this term, 2 to the power d times dn, so that's the number of vertices in this box, times the number of boxes. This is exactly the total number of vertices in the big box, so that's equal to the number of box in the box, and number of vertices in the box dn plus 1. So this and this cancel. Okay, so what remains is just psi dn. And then that was for the upper bound, but I could get in the same way a lower bound. The only thing is that I get a minus here for the lower bound, minus here for the lower bound. So if now I take the both the upper and lower bounds, what I conclude is that psi dn plus 1 minus psi dn, this is smaller than beta d, 2 minus n minus 1. Okay? So obviously it's a Cauchy sequence. That means that psi, which is the limit as n goes to infinity, exists and is finite. Okay. Okay, so that proves the first part, which is convergence along this particular sequence of boxes and with free boundary condition. So now the second step is to use this result to prove that actually the limit exists along any sequence of sets which converges to ZD in the sense of Van't Hoff, and the limit you obtain is the same. But still, we'll do it only for free boundary condition at the moment, and we'll deal with general boundary condition afterwards. So, two. Convergence of psi empty set lambda along arbitrary sequences lambda converging to ZD in the sense of Van't Hoff. So that's step two. And we'll proceed in this way. So let me draw some lambda. So we could have some big hole. So that's this thing here. This is, say, lambda n, okay, considering a sequence lambda n. And then what we will do is that we will first fix some epsilon positive, and then arbitrarily small, and then we'll choose, you will see how in a few minutes, we will choose some number k large enough, depending on epsilon. And we'll consider a partition of the full space ZD into cubes, into cells of side lengths 2 to the power k. So considering a partition. So on and so forth. Okay. So all these cells, they have side length, so this is 2 to the power k. So each of these cells, each of these cubes here is a copy of dk, what we call dk in the first part. Okay. Now among all these cells, I will distinguish those who contain at least one vertex of lambda n. So this cell, I will mark it because it contains some part of lambda n. This I will mark it, contains some part of lambda n, and so on, and so forth. Okay, this one is also kept. This one is kept. This one is kept. This one also, it has a small piece of lambda n. This one, and this one, this one, and this one also, not this one, contains no points of lambda n. Okay. And this set I obtained here in green, which is an approximation, a discretization, if you want, of at the scale 2 to the power k of the set lambda n, this I will denote, sorry, again, lambda n with brackets around it. That's this approximation of lambda n, this big set here. With a hole here. Okay, that's this set. And now the proof is, the idea of the proof is very easy. So we want to show that, so remember psi denotes the limit I got in the first part, the limit along the sequence dn. Okay. I want to show that if I take psi lambda n with free boundary condition and I compare it with psi, okay, compared the limit I obtained before with the pressure in the box lambda n. This I can decompose into a sum of three terms. Certainly this is smaller than, say, psi dk minus psi plus psi the big box minus psi dk plus psi lambda n minus psi in the big box. Okay, hope you can read. Okay, I'm decomposing psi lambda n minus psi as psi lambda n minus psi of the enlarged box plus psi of the enlarged box minus psi dk plus psi dk minus psi, and I take just the sum of the absolute value of the difference, I get an upper bound. Okay, what I want to show is that this guy is smaller than epsilon if I take n large enough. Okay, so I have to show that each of these three guys are smaller than, say, epsilon over 3 once n is chosen large enough. Okay, and maybe k is also chosen large enough, okay, as explained here. So let's do this. One thing is comes for free. So the first term here, there is nothing to do. Or not that there is nothing to do, but we already did all the work. We already know that psi free boundary condition in the box Dn, it converges to psi. So if I take k large enough, this is going to zero. So when I take k large enough, this is smaller than epsilon over 3. So this, we already know that this is smaller than epsilon over 3 for all k larger than some k note of epsilon. Okay, this is small. This is small because of part one. So what remains to be controlled is these two terms here. Okay. So for the second term, we have to do something completely similar to what we just did in the first part. So we'll go a little bit faster. Basically the same argument. What we are going to do is to notice that the pressure, okay, everywhere I should put this free boundary condition. Okay. To be precise. So the pressure in the box lambda n, this big box, the n-large box here, the green box, minus the pressure in one of the small cube. So I would like to compare the two, but I can compare the two exactly as we did before. That is, all these cubes which build up the green set, I can separate them by taking my knife again and cutting everything here, cutting everything there, cutting everything here, cutting everything there, and I will just get a bunch of separate cubes exactly as we had before. Okay, I cut all these interactions everywhere, remove all these interactions, and then I get many disjoint cubes. Okay, and then this should allow me, exactly as before, to compare the pressure in the big box, the green box, and the pressure in each of these small cubes. So let's see what this gives. So the argument is exactly as before. I'm looking at the Hamiltonian with free boundary condition in the box, say in the big box, lambda n, with the bracket. This I can write as the sum from L, which goes from 1 to m. M is total number of boxes here in the big, in the green set. So how many boxes do I have? So m. M is simply given by the cardinality of the green set divided by the cardinality of any of the boxes. That gives me the number of boxes there. Okay. So I sum over this, and then I get the Hamiltonian in dk L, where again I number, so this one is dk1, this guy is dk2, and so on and so forth. Right? I just number all these cubes. And then there is a remainder, r tilde, n. Okay? And I have to bound this remainder. I do it exactly as before by looking at how many interactions here do I have to remove in order to disconnect these cubes from its neighbors? Okay. Well, I can just count how many cubes I have. So I have capital M cubes. Each of them will give me, so each edge gives me a beta. So let's start with this. Then I have capital M cubes. For each of these cubes, I have to disconnect at most, okay, take this one, I have to disconnect all its faces. So it has 2D faces. I have to disconnect its 2D faces. The size of each face is 2 to the power k to the power d minus 1. 2 to the power k to d minus 1. And now observe that this face, I have to disconnect it. So if I consider this cube, I have to remove this face to disconnect it from this cube. But it's also a face that I have to use to disconnect this guy from this guy. So there is a factor of 2. I'm counting twice each face. So I can divide this by 2 if I want. Okay. And then I think we have everything we need. So what do we get? We get beta d. Let me write direct. No, okay. Let me write it like that for the moment. 2 kd minus 1. We'll see later exactly what comes out. So that's the uniform bound we get on the remainder when we make this decomposition. And proceeding exactly as before, this gives us some inequalities between the corresponding partition functions. So this implies that Z empty set lambda n, or let's say for the upper bound, this will be smaller than E beta d m 2 to the power k d minus 1. Okay, that's the error term. And then I will get the product of the partition function in each of these boxes. So each of them gives me a partition function z empty set dk. And I have m of them. And of course, I can again get a lower bound in the same way. The only thing is that I get a minus sign. It's exactly the same argument as before. And once we have that, well, again, you divide by the volume of lambda n. Okay, you take the log, you divide by the volume of lambda n, and you look at what you get. So what you will get, this will lead, exactly as before, to the following inequality, following bound for the difference between the pressure in the green box and the pressure in the box dk. This will be smaller than beta d m 2 to the power k d minus 1 divided by the cardinality of lambda n. Exactly the same argument as before. And now we have to simplify everything that we can. So let's see. So lambda n here, this is m times dk. Okay. There are m cubes, each of size dk. So the m goes away. What dk is just 2 to the power k d. 2 to the power k to the power d, so 2 to the power kd. So we see that the only thing that remains is beta d and 2 to the power minus k. So we get an upper bound on this difference, which is given by beta d2 to the power minus k. And if I choose k large enough, this is smaller than epsilon over 3. For all k larger than, say, k1 of epsilon. So we're done with the second term. This guy is also smaller than epsilon over 3. Okay. Exactly the same argument. So the only thing we have still to do is to control the third term here, which is done in almost the same way, not quite. But it will take more than 1 minute, so we'll do it after the break. So we'll make 15 minutes break now, and we will prove that the third term is also small just after the break. So let's turn to the third and last term here in this decomposition. So now we want to compare the pressure associated to this green set with the pressure of the original set lambda n. So the one which is here. Okay, so that you can do in a completely similar way. Maybe I will start here. Again, the first step is to compare the energy in the two sets. Oops. Compare the energy in the two sets. So I want to compare. I want to write H, say lambda n, empty set. I want to write it as H lambda n, empty set. Okay. And again, I'm making a mistake. So what is the mistake I'm making? Well, for each vertex here, which is in the green set, but which is not in the box lambda n, well, this guy, it has 2D neighbors with which it interacts. So there will be a contribution of the energy coming from this guy, which appears here, but does not appear here. So I will get certainly a 2D beta. This is for the energy of interaction of each vertex in this big set, which is not in the other one. So I will get something like that, which multiply the size of the green set minus, say, let me do it like that, minus lambda n. Okay, that's the number of vertices which are in the green set, but which are not in the original set, lambda n. Okay. For each of those, I get a 2D beta. And then I also get something else, because each of, in the Hamiltonian, I have also a term which is H minus H sum over I omega I. So I get for each of these vertices which sit in this, in the green set but not in the original set, I get a factor of H at worst, so plus absolute value of H. Okay, so that's all I need for the moment. Okay, get something like that. That's an upper bound. Okay. Can do things like that. And I can get a lower bound again by putting a minus sign. And let me just give a name. I don't want to write this 10,000 times. So let me call delta n. This is just the difference between the big green set and the original set. So here, what we have is just the cardinality of delta n. Okay. And now I will use this type of inequality. So let me also write the other bound, since I did it before. So let me see what this tells you about the partition function. So this implies that the partition function in the green box, this will be given by the sum over all configuration in lambda n, e minus h lambda n. But then I also, here in the partition function, which I have here, I have the configuration is not defined only on lambda n, it's defined on the big green set. So I still have to sum of the on the remainder of the partition of the configuration. So that's the part of the configuration which is in lambda n, but there is also a part which is on delta n. I have to say what the spins are on delta n. And then I get the rest. The rest is e minus, or say e plus 2d beta plus h delta n for the upper bound, for example. Okay. But this term here, this is just a constant, does not depend on, okay, I should say omega tilde, does not depend on omega tilde. Just a constant. So what will appear is just this constant times the number of terms I have in this sum. And how many terms do I have in this sum? Well, for each vertex in the green set, which is not in the original set, so each vertex in delta n, I have two choices, either a plus one or a minus one. Okay. So the number of configuration I can make on this set delta n, it's 2 to the power delta n. Okay. So if I put all this together, what I get is that this is smaller than e to the power 2d beta plus h plus log 2, because it comes, which comes from here, plus log 2, everything times delta n, and then times this, which is just the partition function lambda n. And I get, again, lower bounds by changing signs. Okay. Whatever. Okay. I can be very rough and put a minus here. Doesn't change anything for what I want to do. Okay. So now, again, I have some inequalities which relate me the partial function, the big box, with the partial function, the box I'm interested in. I just have to take the logarithm to divide by the volume of the box, and then I will get something which involves the pressures. So what we get is that, say, okay, I will not give all the details. I'll let you check the details, but okay, let's see. So what we get is that the log of z lambda n minus the log of z lambda n, this is smaller than 2d beta plus h plus log 2 delta n. And then what I have to do is I have to divide by the volume of delta n. So here I have to divide by that, but I'm not very happy because this will create me the pressure in the big green set, but this will not. So what I want here is to have lambda n, right? But then I have to correct by putting lambda n over lambda n. Okay. And then here I get this thing. So now the only thing that remains to be done is to get some estimate on the size of delta n and some estimate on the size of the green set, which is basically the same thing. So let's see. So delta n, by definition, it's the cardinality of the number of vertices which are in the big box, in the green box, but which are not in the original box. So how do I compute that? I know that each square I've taken here must contain at least one vertex of lambda n. Okay. For sure, it has to contain at least one vertex of lambda n. Actually, if it's a box which contains a vertex which is not in lambda n, like in this picture, it has to contain a point in the boundary of lambda n. This belongs to the inner boundary of lambda n. Okay. So each of these boxes of which belongs to delta n, they have to contain at least one point which is in the boundary of lambda n. So this is certainly smaller than the size of the boundary of lambda n, the number of vertices which are in the boundary. And for each vertex in the boundary, I just get the total volume of a cube decay. That's a very pessimistic bound. It's a very rough lower bound, okay, of this type. So this is always true. Now, once I have this, I can also immediately deduce that lambda n, which is, let me write it lambda n over lambda n. Maybe it's better. So this is lambda n plus delta n over lambda n. Okay, the size of the green set is the size of the original set plus the size of the difference. This is 1 plus, so this will be bounded by 1 plus this thing. And this is pretty good because it makes this ratio appear, the ratio between the size of the boundary of the box lambda n and the size of the box lambda n itself. Okay? And we know that this term goes to 0 as n goes to infinity, because by assumption, the set lambda n grows in the sense of von Hoff to ZD. Okay, so the ratio between the boundary and the volume is going to zero. Okay, so this is very good. And then we also have a lower bound, which is certainly always bigger than one. Okay. So with using all these things, plugging all these things there, you easily check that this is smaller than epsilon over 3. Let you check the just algebra, check that this is smaller than epsilon over 3. When n is large enough. N larger than n0, which depends on epsilon and on k. So k has been fixed so that this is small and this is small. We fix k larger than both k0 and k1. This was for all k larger than k1 of epsilon. So we take k large enough so that both these terms are smaller than epsilon over 3. And once k is fixed, we take n large enough so that this guy is also smaller than epsilon over 3. Okay. Let you check that. Very easy. So this is smaller than epsilon over 3. So all in all, we conclude that this, so for all n, larger than n naught. So from all this, we conclude that for any epsilon positive, this thing is smaller than epsilon, provided that n is large enough, which means that, indeed, the free boundary condition pressure in the box lambda n converges to psi. Okay? So this proves existence along any sequence of boxes which grow to ZD in the sense of von Hoff, but only for the free boundary condition. Okay? Moreover, it shows that the limit does not depend on the sequence chosen because it's always psi, which was the psi we obtained in the first part. Okay. Good. So third step in the proof is to show that the boundary condition is completely irrelevant. Irrelevance of the boundary condition. Well, this is even simpler. So what you do, so let's take some boundary condition eta. Okay. And what I will do here, I will compare the energy of a configuration which is compatible with the boundary condition eta and the corresponding configuration with free boundary condition. So let me take omega and omega lambda eta. Then I want to say that h lambda of omega, this is h lambda with free boundary condition. And there is a mistake. So again, let's say I have some box lambda here, and then what I'm missing here, that I have here, is the interaction between the spins inside the box and their neighbors outside the box. Okay, I'm missing all these guys, etc. Okay, I'm missing all these guys. So what I'm missing is something which is bounded by beta times the inner boundary of lambda times, say, 2D. I don't want to even think. Okay, beta times some multiplication. Okay, just simple bound. So that's smaller than that. And it's larger than that. Okay, so if now I move, as we did so many times already in the first hour, to the partition function, what I get is that z lambda eta, in one direction it's bounded by e beta inner boundary of lambda, okay, times 2d, times z empty set lambda, and on the other side I get e minus beta, lambda, okay. And then you go to the pressure, so take the log, divide by the volume, and you get this, you get beta times the inner boundary of lambda times 2d, divided by lambda plus psi with free boundary condition, and here you get the same with minus psi. And 2D times Z. Okay. There is a plus. Here. Let me write it properly. 2D. Plus psi. Okay. But now you're done because again, when lambda grows to z in the sense of Van't Hoff, this ratio goes to zero. So this goes to zero. This goes to zero. This is the pressure with free boundary condition, so it goes to psi. This goes to psi. Okay. So this goes to psi. Okay, very easy. So the only remaining claims are kind of obvious. It's the claim about convexity and the claim about the fact that it's an even the pressure is an even function of h. This follows immediately from the corresponding volume in the corresponding statement in finite volume. Let's quickly do it. So this was 3, so 4 finite properties. So psi is the pointwise limit of convex function. That was lemma, I don't know, some lemma we proved last week. Do we have the number? This lemma. Otherwise, you will check. This. 3.7, thank you. The lemma. 3.7. So it's convex. So the pointwise limit of convex function is obviously convex. So that's the first thing. And the second thing, we have seen that psi in lambda with free boundary condition at beta h is the same as beta minus h. This was exercise something. Exercise whatever, I let you check. We saw it last week. And so this guy converges to psi of beta h, and this guy converges to psi of beta minus h. So psi of beta h must be equal to psi of beta minus h. Okay. So this concludes the proof of this theorem. Something I wanted to say. Okay, so that was about the pressure. So now we know that the pressure in infinite volume is well defined, has nice properties. But the pressure is not the quantity we are directly interested in. It's a good way to get access to the quantity we are directly interested in, but it's not the quantity we are directly interested in, which is the magnetization density. So let's see what we can say about the magnetization density. So we have seen that in finite volume, the magnetization density could be obtained from the pressure by differentiation. Okay, let's call this star. So something that will be extremely important for us is to understand to what extent this identity star admits an infinite volume equivalent. Is there something equivalent, some infinite volume magnetization density, which is just given by the derivative of the infinite volume pressure? So does can admit an infinite volume version. So this question is important, but it's actually several questions simultaneously. So let's try to see exactly what this means. This really means several things. On one hand, does this quantity admit a limit? So does limit as lambda grows to ZD in the sense of Van Hove does this exist? Can we take the limit of this quantity and does this exist? So for the pressure, it exists. Does it also exist for the magnetization? We'll see that the situation is much more complicated for the magnetization. So that's the first question. So if it exists, then the second question about this, the generalization of this identity, can be translated as follows. So note that DDH psi lambda. Okay, let me do it like that. DDH psi, so if I take the derivative of the limiting pressure, so this guy, we know it exists, so I can compute, I can hope that I can compute its derivative, and this would be given by, if it exists, this will be given by DDH limit of something like that. Okay, this is obtained as a limit of finite volume pressure, so I get something like that. On the other hand, this okay, let me omit the beta h. This is really the limit as lambda goes to ZD, and this m lambda dies, and this m lambda hash or whatever, this finite volume magnetization density, it's given by the derivative of the finite volume pressure. Okay, so if I want to show that this quantity is given by the derivative of psi, is this true? That would be the equivalent in infinite volume of this identity. So whether this is equal to this amounts to determining whether I can interchange two limits. So I have the limit as lambda goes to ZD and the derivative differentiation with respect to H. Okay, so is it possible to interchange? Operation. The answer will turn out not to be trivial. So where have I? Have I let my stuff? Here. So that's the kind of question we are going to consider now. So let me just, before doing that, let me just do two things. Maybe I'll do it like that. So, okay. We'll see that in general, so it will take us a couple of weeks, at least additional weeks, to fully answer this question. When is it possible? Is it at all possible? And when is it possible? And however, just from what we did today, from the convexity of the infinite volume pressure, we can already answer this question almost everywhere. Actually, everywhere outside the countable set. And this just follows from the convexity of the pressure. So convexity of psi allows us to answer these questions almost everywhere, in a very strong sense. Everywhere, for almost every age. Okay. So let me explain that. So for this, since I want to use convexity of psi to deduce these properties, I need to know something about convex functions. So let me give you state your result about convex function, which lists a series of results about convex function. that if you are not familiar with, you can find the proofs in the appendix of the book, which is also available on the page. So in the book, it's theorem A14 in the appendix. It tells you the following. So let F, say from R to R, be convex, convex real function. Okay. Then F has the following property. We have the following properties. So first, D plus F, which is the right derivative of F. So let me, this is just the limit as y decreases to x, f of y minus f of x, y minus x. Okay. This always exists. So right derivative always exists, and left derivative also always exists. So d minus f of x, which is the same limit, y increases to x of the same thing always exists. Okay. So directional derivative, there is no problem for convex function. They always exist. Second property that I will need is the fact that d minus f of x, so the left derivative at x, is always smaller or equal to the right derivative at x. That's always true. The third property is that the right derivative at x is always smaller than the left derivative at y if y is larger than x. Disordering. From this and this, you immediately deduce that d plus f and d minus f, so the left and right derivative are both non-decreasing. Then we also have that d plus f is right continuous, and that d minus f is left continuous. Almost done. The set of all points x at which the right and left derivative of f do not coincide . So which is exactly the set of points where f is not differentiable, right? Because the right and left derivative, they always exist. So the only way for f not to be differentiable is when they do not agree. So this is at most countable. Okay, and the last one, last property I need, is about limits of convex functions. It tells you the following, so it's 7. The numbering is supposed to be the same as in theorem A14, if I've made no mistakes. So suppose that Gn is a sequence of convex functions, a sequence of convex functions. Gn is going from R to R. And they are such that they converge pointwise to some function g. Okay. So we have a sequence of convex function gn converging to some limiting convex function g. Then, if g is differentiable at x, so if the limiting function is differentiable at x, then, okay, we have that the derivative of g at x is given by the limit, or not of the derivative of gn at x, because maybe they are not differentiable at x, but they certainly have left and right derivative because they are convex. So limit n to infinity of d plus gn of x, but also the limit n to infinity of d minus g mod x. So that's all. So these are the properties of convex function that I need. Each of them is proved in 3-4 lines. It's very simple. And it's done in the appendix. So if you're curious and you don't know how to prove that, you can just read it there. Okay, so what can we say about, what does it tell us in our case? So first, it tells us from point one, we immediately know that, okay, here when I was writing derivative with respect to h of psi, it's not clear that, that these things even exist. Okay, it's not clear that psi is differentiable. But what is clear is that the right and left derivative exist. So d plus h, which means the derivative, the right derivative with respect to h of psi, and d minus h of psi exists for all beta h. So that's a consequence of one, okay, and the convexity of psi. So certainly we can speak about the derivatives, left and right derivatives. Then suppose that, okay, let me say it like that. So the fact that what I'm really interested in is not left and right derivative, it's this derivative. So the existence of this, so psi differentiable at h, differentiable with respect to h, with respect to h at some point at beta h, this is equivalent to saying that d plus h psi beta h is equal to d minus h psi beta h, because the left and right derivative, they exist. So if they coincide, then the function is just differentiable with respect to h, and that's fine. If they do not coincide, then it's not differentiable. So it's an equivalence. So the point where this quantity makes sense, I can give it a name. So I will introduce, actually I will introduce its complement. So I introduce a set which I will call B beta. So for all beta, I introduce a set B beta, which is the set of all bad values of H. So this is the set of all H in R, such that psi is not differentiable, which is the same as the set of all H in R, at which D plus H psi is different from beta H, different from D minus H psi beta H. Okay, this is the set of bad values of H, the one where this thing does not even exist. And one thing I can immediately say is that this guy is not too big. So for every beta, this set is a set of non-differentiability point of a convex function, and we have from 6 here that it's at most countable. So this is at most countable by 6. So it's a small set. For each beta, it's a small set. We'll see that it's a much smaller set than that, in fact. But for the moment, that's all we can say. So let me now state what we can say about the magnetization density. So we can say a lot of things about magnetization density outside this bad set. On this bad set, we don't know anything at the moment, but outside this bad set, we can say everything we want. So that's, I don't know if it's a theorem or a corollary. Let me see. Corollary. V12. So for all H, which is not in this bad set, the average magnetization density, average magnetization density, which is defined as m of beta h, it's the limit as lambda increases to z in the sense of Von Rolle of m lambda or some arbitrary boundary condition, beta h, this quantity is well defined. It's independent of the sequence lambda chosen and the boundary condition. Okay, exactly as the pressure. Moreover, it satisfies m of beta h is equal to derivative with respect to h psi beta h. At this h. So for h not in b beta, this quantity is well defined, and then if you compute the derivative, you get m beta h. Okay, let me call this star star. Finally, we still have a few things we can say. Moreover, the function h goes to m of beta h. So m seen as a function of the magnetic field is non-decreasing on r minus b beta. Okay. It's continuous, or piecewise continuous. Let's say piecewise continuous. Okay. Continuous on each. Continuous with each component of r minus b beta. Okay. Remove the bad points. In each component, it's actually a continuous function. And it's exactly discontinuous at the points of b beta. Discontinuous at each h in b beta. So it really behaves badly on b beta. It really jumps. And what you can say is that the limit as h goes down, at h prime goes down to h, where all the h prime take them in bb, outside b beta, so the limit of m beta h prime, this is given by, so it's a generalization of star star star. What you get is the right derivative, the plus h psi beta h. And if you compute the limit h prime goes up to h of m of beta h prime, then you get the left derivative. Okay, so it's discontinuous because by assumption on b beta, these two quantities do not agree. So the limit, the right limit and the left limit do not coincide. These two guys are not equal. Good, so in particular, it's the end of the. I would have just one additional sentence to write. This statement. Which is a definition. In particular, the spontaneous magnetization which is defined as m star of beta is the limit as h goes down to zero of m of beta h is always well defined. Good. So that the statement, let's prove it. We have enough time to prove it. It's because it's very simple. Just apply these things. So let's fix some h not in b beta. Then we have that. So I will simultaneously prove all the first claims there. So we start with the derivative. So I'm not on B beta, so I can compute the I can differentiate the pressure with respect to H. This is a well-defined quantity outside B beta. And this is given by what? This is the derivative of the limit as lambda goes to ZB of psi. We fix some boundary condition in some sequence lambda which goes to Z the instance of Anov, arbitrarily one, because this does not depend on the way you chose them, of this. Now, this, so the function psi is the pointwise limit of this convex function psi lambda dies, psi lambda h. So you know that when the limit is differentiable by 0.7 here, when the limit is differentiable, then the derivative of the limit is the limit of the derivatives. So this is equal to, so that's the derivative of the limit of this sequence of functions. So by 7, it's the limit of the derivative. So I can write this limit derivative. So here I could choose either left or right derivative, but actually these guys are differentiable everywhere. So you can just put the real derivative, doesn't matter. If you prefer, you can put right or left, does not change anything. Lambda is, okay, let's not put beta h. Everything is at beta h. But this, by star, this is just equal to m lambda h of beta h. Derivative of this by star is just m. So what we get is limit as lambda increases to zd of m lambda h. So what does this tell you? It tells you that outside b beta, this quantity, for arbitrary sequence lambda and arbitrary boundary condition, the limit exists. It's given by the derivative, right? It does not depend on the chosen sequence of volume or on the boundary condition, right? Because all these identities are independent of that. So so this implies that implies existence of limit independence of the sequence lambda and the boundary condition. And finally, it also implies star, star, because okay, we immediately established that the limit is actually given by the derivative. Okay. So this proves almost everything we wanted. So this proves that this is well defined, this is independent of lambda and of the boundary condition, it satisfies star, star. So what remains to be shown is that are these properties. So moreover, so we want the fact that it's non-decreasing outside B beta. So now what we are going to use is the fact that, okay, by M beta H is DDH psi beta H. Okay, now the derivative of psi at H, it's the same as the right derivative, because the derivative exists. So it's the same thing as the right derivative, and the right derivative are non-decreasing by 0.4. So this is non-decreasing by 4. Okay, that's done. One thing. Another thing is about continuity on the components. So this immediately comes from the fact that the same, again, by star star, this is true. And okay, m, okay, the same thing. Observe the same thing. But now I know by by 5 that the right derivative is right continuous and the left derivative is left continuous. But the right derivative and left derivative, they agree on all the components of R minus the bad set. Okay, so they are at, so the function, the derivative are at the same time right and left continuous. They're continuous. Continuous on each component of R minus B beta by 5. Okay. So the only thing that remains to be shown is the fact that at points of B beta, at the bad points, there is a discontinuity. It's almost the same, so let me do it here. No, yes, I don't need it anymore.
Let me do it here.
Okay. So let's say HK be a sequence in R minus B beta such that HK decreases to H, which belongs to B beta. Okay. This you can always do because this set is at most countable, so you can always avoid its points. And get a sequence which converges to H from above. Okay. Then, and I will start from this side. Then D plus H psi beta H. So this exists. This is equal by, so where is it? By 0.5 again. The D plus is right continuous. So the right derivative at H is the limit of the right derivative at HK. So this is equal to the limit as K goes to infinity of D plus HK, D plus H, sorry, of psi beta HK. Okay. But at HK, psi is actually differentiable. So this is the limit K to infinity of DH psi of beta h, and by star star, this is the limit k to infinity, this is m of beta, sorry, hk. Okay. So we indeed get that the limit of m beta h prime, as h prime goes down to h, is given by the right derivative. The proof for the left derivative is the same, so I won't do it. This proves this result. Just 1 minute to conclude, to make a summary of what we know now. So for the moment, the picture is as follows. And I will finish with that. So if we draw m of beta h as a function of h, so there are some bad points. These are the points. So these are the points of B beta. That's the nasty one. But on the complement of these points, things are very nice. So the magnetization, it exists. So maybe it's doing that. It's increasing. I mean, it's not decreasing, at least. Making some jumps at each of these points. Okay. Here also, it's jumping. Always upward, huh? It's an increasing function. We have a picture of this type. At the moment, the only thing we know about the magnetization is that it's an increasing piecewise continuous function which jumps exactly at the points of the set B beta. Okay. And so the only thing that remains for us to show is that does there exist beta c in zero infinity such that b beta is the empty set for all beta smaller than beta c, and b beta is the point zero for all beta larger than beta c. If we prove that, then that means that in this case, the picture you have is that there is no jump, the function is increasing, it's continuous everywhere, and it's actually odd because the pressure was even. That's an even function, so the derivative of an even function is an odd function, so this is odd and continuous, so you get a picture like that for all high temperature, and here you get that it's continuous and increasing everywhere except at the origin where it jumps, which would be this claim. So what we have to do is to answer this question now. So that's what we will start doing next week. Okay. Are there questions about, yes?
Do you know that B beta is actually a discrete set?
We know it's an Atmos countable set.
So it can have actually some limit point.
It could. Okay. It could. But it won't actually. It will have zero or one point. But a priori, it could. Other questions? Sorry?
The function M.
Where?
Here, left corner.
Here?
It's always especially left odd in H.
Oh.
Sorry, I've not understood.
Supposed
to be odd. Oh, okay, sorry. Yes. Yes. Okay, it should be odd. Picture would be more complicated to draw. Okay, plus it's odd. But actually it does not look like that, right? It will look like that or like that. You're right, of course. It should be odd. Make it odd on your picture. Okay. But it's clear where we are. So we already know quite a lot of things which came for free. I mean, we just had to prove that the pressure is convex, and then we automatically get all these nice properties about the magnetization density. And this reduces the whole problem to this one. But to study this one, we need a new approach. So something different. One approach to solve this problem is, of course, to compute psi. If you're able to compute explicitly the pressure, then you're done because you compute it and you just check that it's differentiable everywhere except at zero or everywhere. Okay, that would be one way to do it. The point is that the problem is that this can only be done in dimension one. You have done it as an exercise, I think, already. This you can only do it in dimension one. In dimension two, you can do it, but only when h is equal to zero. So it gives you exactly zero information about what we want. Okay, you cannot even compute differentiation with respect to h, because you only have it at h equals zero. So the only case where you can compute things is equal one. So you need another approach. We cannot access psi directly, so we need something, some other way of getting information about psi and m without going to exact computations. Okay, I'll explain that next week.